100 years ago, a German architect came up with probably the most insane plan in history. He wanted to quite literally drain the ocean. When it comes to engineering megaprojects, it was the most ambitious proposal ever. Nothing else even comes close to it. Not the pyramids of Giza, not the Hoover Dam, not even the Panama Canal. But why did he want to do it? And could his plan have worked? To understand this fascinating story, we need to go back to the 19th century, when a lot of Europeans, especially in Germany, were talking about something called Lebensraum. In English, Lebensraum means living space, and it's a relatively simple idea. As a country's population increases, the people in that country will need more space. In the 1920s, this idea came to the attention of Adolf Hitler and had a major effect on his worldview. He decided that as the German nation grew in power, it would need a lot more living space. Other Europeans had the same idea. Populations were skyrocketing all across the continent, and there wasn't enough room for everyone. These bloated countries were jostling for space, like swelling balloons in a cramped room. And many people at the time thought it was a matter of time before the balloons began to pop. There were energy demands to consider too. As populations rose, so would energy requirements, which meant raw materials like coal and oil would become more and more essential. All in all, it felt like a matter of time before war over new living space broke out in Europe. These growing countries needed land and resources, and their only option was to take those things from each other. At least, that felt like their only option. But in the 1920s, another German began to study the problem from an entirely new perspective. His name was Hermann Zorgo, and he came up with one of the most astonishing plans in history. He called it Atlantropa. This name was a combination of Atlantic and Europa, and it was meant to remind people of Atlantis, the mythical underwater city. And it's hard to say which sounds more realistic, the myth of Atlantis or the plans for Atlantropa. To put it simply, Zorgo wanted to drain the Mediterranean. By emptying that massive body of water, he could free up new land for European settlement and solve the problem of Lebensraum without anyone going to war. The Mediterranean is roughly 8 times larger than modern Germany. That's a lot of unused space. Zorgel envisioned vast swaths of land reclaimed from the depths and transformed into fertile plains. He envisioned beautiful networks of towns and cities where people were free to live in peace without worrying about running out of space. Even better, with the Mediterranean out of the way, it would be easier to travel from Europe to Africa. That would open up yet more living space, as people from Europe could move to Africa and build new cities and homes. Zorgel's vision was actually inspired by a real geological event. An interesting feature of the Mediterranean is that water evaporates from the surface of the sea at a faster rate than water arrives from rivers. The only reason the level of the sea doesn't drop over time is the Atlantic Ocean, which flows into the region via the Strait of Gibraltar, keeping the water at a constant level. But about 5 million years ago, the Strait of Gibraltar was closed off by shifting tectonic plates. The Mediterranean was isolated, and without Atlantic waters flowing in from the west, it slowly started to shrink. As the water level dropped by hundreds of meters, it revealed giant patches of land. Thousands of years later, the Strait of Gibraltar opened again, and a massive flood of Atlantic water refilled the Mediterranean basin. But for a short period, the Mediterranean had shrunk right down to a tiny sea, and the total land area of the European continent had massively increased as a result. Millions of years later, Zorgel wanted to find a way to recreate all of this, but he knew he couldn't wait for the tectonic plates to move again. Instead, he would need to resort to civil engineering. And so, this was Zorgel's insane plan. The main feature of Zorgel's ambitious proposal was to build a dam across the Strait of Gibraltar, replacing the tectonic closure of this stretch of water with a man-made version instead. Building this dam would not be easy. At its deepest point, the Strait of Gibraltar was 900 meters deep. And even in some of the shallower areas, it was still 300 meters from the top of the water to the bottom. Back then, no dam had ever been built at a height of 300 meters, and even today, only a couple of dams have ever passed that mark. Both of those are in China, the Jinping One and the Nurek. The depth of the water was only one of the challenges. Zorgel would also need to deal with the significant width of the strait. At its narrowest point, the body of water is 13 kilometers from one side to the other. And when it comes to dam building, that's a massive distance. To put it into perspective, the Jinping 1 and the Nurek Dam only cross a distance of 600 meters and 700 meters, respectively. In other words, Sorgel's dam across the Strait of Gibraltar wouldn't only need to be significantly taller than the largest dams in history, it would also need to be 20 times longer from one end of the dam to the other. Already, Atlantropus sounds wildly ambitious, but this was only the start. After damming the Atlantic, Sorgel also wanted to dam the Dardanelles Strait, in the hope of separating the Mediterranean from the Black Sea. This was only a slightly less difficult project than the dam across the Gibraltar Strait, but it would still have been more than 1 kilometer across. Working together, Sorgel wanted these colossal dams to isolate the Mediterranean, so that the water level could start to drop. But still, there was more to his astonishing plans. After isolating the Mediterranean, he wanted to build another dam between Sicily and Tunisia, effectively cutting the giant sea into two separate halves. This dam proposal was even more ambitious than the others. The distance between the coast of Sicily and the coast of Tunisia was more than 150 kilometers. Sorgel planned to use this dam to allow the two halves of the Mediterranean to drop to different levels. He wanted the water level in the western half to drop by a distance of 100 meters, while the water in the eastern half would drop by twice as much. This all sounds way overcomplicated, but it was actually based on some careful calculations. In terms of land reclamation, the coastal geography of the two regions meant that 100 meters was the ideal drop for the western half, while 200 meters was the ideal drop for the east. Together, these descending water levels were expected to reveal up to 700,000 square kilometers of land. To put that into perspective, it's double the size of Germany. This would certainly have solved Europe's living space problem in terms of area, but you guessed it, there was more to this plan. Sorgel was much aware that overpopulation would threaten Europe's power supplies. Because of this, he wanted Atlantropa's superdams to double up as hydroelectric power stations. These stations would generate enough electricity to support any cities that were built in the region, as well as providing power to other parts of Europe. In other words, Sorgel didn't only want to turn the Mediterranean into a giant living space, he also wanted to turn the sea into a giant water-powered battery. Looking back, it all sounds absurdly ambitious, but at the time, it was relatively popular. Sorgel wrote several books on Atlantropa, as well as publishing hundreds of leaflets and articles, and lots of people were excited by the thought of a peaceful solution to the problem of overpopulation. Even a few politicians were impressed. They'd rather spend money on Atlantropa than spend the same amount of money on a war, right? Contemporary architects and civil engineers began to improve on Sorgel's ideas. A new plan emerged to block the Strait of Gibraltar using a series of dams instead of the single dam that Sorgel originally proposed. These dams would function like steps or terraces, holding back the water of the Atlantic Ocean at smaller, more manageable levels. There would be a lot less pressure on each of these dams and less risk of collapse as they shared the load of the water between them. This was still a wildly ambitious proposal, but some people thought it could work. They were also inspired by the Zuiderzee works taking place in the Netherlands at the time. Using a massive system of dams and dikes, the country had managed to hold back part of the North Sea and reclaim a piece of the land. This project was nowhere near as ambitious as Atlantropa, but it was still an extremely impressive achievement and one that gave Sorgel hope. And as his confidence grew, he started to come up with even bigger ideas than before. He suggested that the entire European continent should be connected to a single central power grid, and that if any country tried to start a war, the other countries would just turn their power off until that country was forced to surrender. He also wanted a system of canals in places like Italy and Egypt. When the sea level dropped, Venice and Cairo would suddenly find themselves high and dry, completely cut off from the seabound trade that they had always historically relied upon. But with a network of canals connecting these cities to the shrunken waters of the Mediterranean, Sorgel planned to make sure that boats and ships could still reach these important destinations. Yeah, this sounds like a great plan. On top of all of this, he expanded his plans to connect Europe to Africa and create a single continent called, you guessed it, Eurafrica. He wanted to build yet another dam across the Congo River and use it to create a freshwater inland sea. This water could be used to irrigate the Sahara Desert and turn the area into luscious arable land. In Sorgel's own words, he wanted to turn it into territory actually useful to Europe. The area would then be connected to countries in Europe by a series of railways, including tracks that ran over the top of the dam across the Strait of Gibraltar and the dam between Sicily and Tunisia. Of course, not everybody liked these proposals. In hindsight, they reflected the colonialist tone in Europe at the time and didn't take into account the people who already lived in Africa. People who didn't want a stream of Europeans flowing into the continent and claiming the land as their own. Sorgel may have wanted to avert the crisis of war in Europe, but he didn't seem to care about disrupting the lives of African citizens instead. And obviously, this wasn't the only criticism of the Atlantropa project as a whole. Even if the project could properly be built, a lot of people were worried about public safety. What if an earthquake or a terrorist attack caused one of the dams to collapse? The Atlantic Ocean would rush back into the Mediterranean, completely obliterating all the towns and cities that Sorgel had managed to build. There was also the overall cost to consider. It's difficult to know an exact figure, but this project would have cost an eye-watering sum. The Zuiderzee works cost well over $1 billion, and they were hundreds of times smaller than Atlantropa. To raise enough money to complete the project, all the countries in Europe would have needed to contribute. And in the years before the European Union, such a massive level of cooperation was hardly likely to happen. Finally, and perhaps most obviously, people questioned if the project was even feasible. A lot of engineers just didn't think that Sorgel's plans would work, and looking back at them now, those engineers were probably right. Even today, no dam has been built that comes close to the ones envisioned by Sorgel. In the end, despite a lifelong campaign, he never had the chance to put his plans into action. Instead, he had to watch his greatest fears come to pass. In the 1930s, Adolf Hitler and the Nazi Party set out from Germany, Sorgel's home country, in the hope of finding more Lebensraum. This wasn't the only thing that drove them, but it was certainly a key motivation. So began the Second World War, as countries in Europe tried to defend themselves against the aggressive Nazi advance. Not long after seeing his continent fall apart, Sorgel was killed in a car accident. After his death, the dream of Atlantropa quickly faded. But what do you think? Is Sorgel's plan a good idea, and is it even possible to build such a massive megaproject? Let us know in the comments below. If you want to learn more about the Congo Dam we mentioned earlier, you should check out our video about it. Thank you for watching, and as always, we'll see you in the next video.